The Republic of Turkey, at the eastern end of the Mediterranean, is one of the world's oldest countries, yet one of its newest nations. It was established as a republic in 1923. In size, it is approximately 296,000 square miles. It measures 300 miles from north to south and 900 miles from west to east. It is the home of some 21 million Turks and a uniquely important country. In introducing Turkey, we are concerned with three major Turkish cities. Ankara is the nation's present capital. Formerly and for several centuries, it was Istanbul, while the very first Ottoman capital was Bursa. We shall visit all three. In all the Mediterranean basin, no country is more strategically located than Turkey. It lies in both Europe and Asia, and her people share the cultures and the problems of both in their bicontinental homeland. Turkey is an important and good friend of the USA. Take an outline map of the United States. Then take one of Turkey drawn to the same scale. Superimposed, you find Turkey stretches from, say, Chicago in the north to the edge of Tennessee in the south, and from Kansas City in the Midwest to Baltimore in the east. Or, put another way, Turkey is somewhat larger than the state of Texas. Let's introduce Turkey in New York City's Rockefeller Center, looking down into the plaza from a 43rd floor window. Here, Prometheus, poised with his gift of fire, is surrounded by United Nations flags. Turkey is one of UN's important members, and its flag flies here. Prometheus' gift of fire has been put to modern use in the plains of our air age. Modern aviation has indeed brought the nations of the world more closely together than ever before. Today, it is a comparatively simple matter to board a plane at New York City's International Airport and fly to Turkey in little over a day and a half. Large American-built ships are in service across the Atlantic to Europe and to the Near East. So, in this air age, Turkey has become an American neighbor. A small community of world travelers headed for the friendly nations of the old world will accompany you. For the next few hours, you will be in a sky world of your own, 2 or 3 miles above the earth. In a matter of minutes after boarding your airliner, you are taxiing down a runway and into position for a takeoff. 2 or 3 planes may be ahead of you, but it is soon your turn. Minutes later, you are winging your way out over the broad Atlantic, and you settle down for a pleasant voyage. Meals have already been stowed aboard to be served aloft along the way. A piping hot filet mignon and a frozen dessert served 3 miles up accent the age in which we live. Evening finds you sailing over a golden sea of clouds hiding the Atlantic Ocean's vast expanse. Some hours later, Europe is passing beneath your plane. You look down to find the English Channel in a foggy frame of mind today. It gives way to France and Paris, spread out along the River Seine. Soon there are the well-cultivated fields of Germany below. You may spend a night on the ground in Switzerland and off early the next morning for Turkey. Before long, blue waters of the Mediterranean and sun-baked shores of Italy and Greece have appeared. From Greece, it is but a matter of minutes, and you are in Turkey. So, disembark, and the formalities of entering a friendly country are soon in back of you. The capital city of Ankara best symbolizes modern Turkey. Let's go there first and see it. In one generation, it has jumped from an unkempt village to its present surprising proportions. In all the world, only Turkey has experienced such a rapid transition in so many aspects of its national life. It presents one of the great stories of progress of our time. It is fitting that a statue of the late great leader Atatürk should be among the first sights to greet you. No person in modern times has had a more profound or far-reaching influence upon his country than he. Turkey's National Assembly, as visualized by Atatürk, meets in this building and operates much as does the Congress in the government of the United States. Atatürk was instrumental in bringing the reign of the Ottoman sultans to an end and in establishing the present republican form of government. Atatürk sensed the importance of transportation, and today a well-run rail system serves the nation. At Ankara station, you find modern diesel trains. Mutual Security Agency funds at the disposal of the Turkish government have been spent in part on her transport system, promoting both military and economic welfare. Since Turkey has an abundance of coal, most of her locomotives are coal burners. Coal is a major Turkish resource. Atatürk created a modern school system to serve his people. The University of Ankara is but one of its units. Quiet during the summer, except for a few special students, but a beehive of activity throughout the rest of the year. As you walk about the buildings of various government departments, you are struck by the up-to-date and business-like atmosphere prevailing. There is nothing in appearance here to set this apart from similar sections of, say, Washington, D.C. It is not uncommon to encounter Mr. Celal Bayar, President of the Republic of Turkey, going about the business of government in Ankara or in other Turkish communities. He travels extensively throughout the country. As the nation's president, he is a much respected and admired personage and moves freely among his people. In fact, Turkey is such an orderly country that the president moves in public in perfect safety, though admiring throngs may unintentionally impede his progress on some occasions. While looking at Ankara streets today, it is hard to realize this was a small town three decades ago. Boulevards, buses, trackless trolleys are more symbolic of Turkey today than a fez, once a badge of Ottoman citizenship, but long since outlawed. Any fez you see today in Turkey is being worn by a visitor from abroad. You may experience considerable difficulty in deciding who is Turkish and who a visitor. Is this boy, reading his comic book at a bus stop, a young Turk, or the son of an American technician living in Ankara? Let's guess the comic book reader is an American boy living in this suburban residential area, with its modern housing development enjoyed alike by American and Turk. Here comes a Turkish family now. This young miss speaks no English, but uses the universal language of a smile. In this suburb on market day, we find familiar-looking things for sale and familiarly dressed people going about their shopping. From nearby farms, the freshest of vegetables and fruits come to this open marketplace at bargain prices, and with many suppliers to choose from. In its haste to grow up, Ankara has not overlooked the need for recreational areas for the people. City parks are an agreeable result of careful planning. Gardens and landscaping have contributed to the transformation of what was once a swamp. Here, a bed of petunias is as much at home as it would be in an American city. Once all the hills in Ankara looked like these sun-baked ones. In the dry interior, water is a scarce commodity. The city supply is carefully stored behind the Çubuk Dam, a few miles outside of town. You are welcome here and invited to enjoy the walks and gardens, along with the good-natured crowds found here on summer days and nights. As in the city, a visit to the gardens is a rewarding one. A good road connects this area with Ankara. A few minutes' ride puts you back in town. A state opera company has a modern opera house at its disposal. Here, famous operas of the world make their contribution to the cultural life of the community. Be found on the outskirts of the city. Here, modern medicine is placed at the disposal of an ever-increasing percentage of the city's 300,000 people. The Institute of Public Health has an important biological laboratory producing vaccines and other biological products. As you look at this housing project, you find the city bursting at the seams, building new housing units for its expanding population. Along with such growth, Turkey is experiencing a continued improvement in its general standard of living. The government has new quarters being built for its occupancy too. Structures not only functional, but likewise very modern. This is certainly in keeping with the progressive spirit one encounters throughout Turkey today. The U.S. government has kept pace with the construction of a new residence for its ambassador. It occupies a fine site overlooking the city. Amid all the growth and change, nothing has been more far-reaching than the complete emancipation of women. In the relatively short time since Turkish women emerged from complete seclusion, they have taken their places in every walk of life. Mrs. Teze Tashkuran is a National Assembly deputy, equivalent of a congresswoman in the USA. Her sister, Mrs. Süreyya Aoğlu, is a prominent corporation attorney. Active participation of Turkish women in the political life of their country is all the more striking when you realize their emancipation dates from the end of World War I. These people are eating sherbet, one of a few Turkish words found in its original form in the English language. Turkish women are playing an important role in the field of medicine and making an invaluable contribution to the welfare of their nation. As Dr. Tarsi talks with one of her patients, it is apparent that a friendly and effective bedside manner aids this skillful surgeon. Here is a patient on the road to recovery. Turkey has been prompt to take advantage of modern medicine and modern hospital techniques. You will find smooth integration of both in Turkish national life. There was a day in Turkey when the field of athletics was strictly a man's province. It was once unheard of for women to participate in sports. This was indeed yesterday, as evidenced by this young woman whom we would say appears quite thoroughly and pleasantly emancipated. Yet in terms of emancipation, Miss Ginseli Bashar may best symbolize the change in the lives of Turkish women. In a recent beauty contest in Rome, where many of Europe's modern beauty queens competed, Miss Bashar was awarded the title of Miss Europe, an enviable achievement considering the highly competitive field. Being interviewed over the air in her homeland, she shares with her listeners the happiness at having won this title for Turkey. It seems the radio station where Miss Bashar is being photographed is missing an opportunity for publicity in having no identifying station initials on the microphone. But it is possibly just as well. Under the circumstances, no one would have noticed them anyway. All this is in sharp contrast to the old citadel frowning down from its lofty height above the capital. This area's known history began fully 5,000 years ago. Wars and earthquakes have periodically shattered these walls. Rebuilt many times, stones from old Roman Greek temples were sometimes used as building material. Round ends of old fluted columns jut out of walls where they were pressed into service long ago. Occasionally, statues cut in relief on rectangular blocks by ancient Roman or Greek or Seljuk now find themselves lying on their sides, head high in citadel walls. The stones of which these statues were a part were used in some ancient rebuilding. Today, such relics would find their way into Turkish museums. Houses are crowded within the old walls. Narrow lanes serve only pedestrian traffic. Here you may meet countrywomen who have come to the city in village costumes, or see children at play making a game of being photographed. A camera, let's hide. Yet, looking at a busy intersection in the new Ankara, it is easy to forget much of Turkey was once like the citadel. The neglect accompanying endless wars for the preservation of empire was swept away when Atatürk implemented the rebuilding of his nation. It is fitting his body should lie in Ankara, a perpetual guard of honor outside his present resting place. A new mausoleum for the father of modern Turkey has arisen on a hilltop overlooking the city. Both mausoleum and Ankara will be appropriate reminders of Atatürk down through the corridors of history. While a completely modern community such as Ankara may have been unexpected, Istanbul, the former capital, is the historic Turkey you may well have expected, a fabulous city of mosques and palaces. 500 years ago, Mehmet II conquered Istanbul from its Byzantine rulers. Since then, it has been a Turkish city, and for the intervening centuries, the seat of government of the Ottoman Empire, which ruled over a vast domain. The Galata Bridge over the famous Golden Horn joins old Istanbul with the quarter called Galata. The hill above it was once a fortified stronghold of Genoese merchants. The bridge is not over the Bosphorus, but joins two segments of the city. From Galata, you look back toward the Mosque of Suleiman the Magnificent, a truly remarkable structure. Yet, in the opinion of many, the Mosque of Sultan Ahmed, called the Blue Mosque, is the more magnificent. It is a striking example of Turkish design with its tall, thin, pinpointed minarets. Turkey is a Muslim country with approximately 96% of the people of the Muslim faith. Yet, it is a secularized nation with complete separation of church and state. This Blue Mosque, with its cascading domes, is a 17th century masterpiece of Turkish religious architecture. In the courtyard are an ablution fountain and the domed areas that once served as school quarters. Three Turkish sailors are looking in at the main entrance to the building. Anyone is welcome in a Turkish mosque, but it is customary to remove shoes before entering, and at the moment they are only sightseeing. At various times a day, a muezzin climbs the narrow stairs within a minaret, and from a balcony calls the faithful to prayer, cupping his hands to carry his voice above the noises of the city. At such a time, those who are going to participate in the current service will enter the mosque. These two children are about to get some basic religious education, plus a lesson in economics as well. Shoes are expensive. Take them with you so you'll know where they are. If one so wishes, they may be checked outside, and this is frequently done. The Bayezid Mosque is another very interesting one. In the decoration of all mosques, you notice the use of only geometric and floral designs, and pictographs of Arabic writing, the latter invariably quotations from the Quran. Islamic religious law forbids the use of human or animal forms in the interests of preventing the worship of images or idols. Bayezid is also called the Pigeon Mosque. It is easy to see why. Nearby, a soft drink seller dispenses sherbet to a student soldier. Sherbet is a beverage in Turkey, whereas in the USA, the name is applied to an ice. Historically, Santa Sofia is most unique. Built as a Christian church, later altered to a mosque, its 1400 years make it the world's oldest functioning structure. Today, along with adjacent buildings, it is a museum. The Dolmabahce Mosque, standing by the edge of the Bosphorus, is likewise a museum. So is the nearby Dolmabahce Palace. Built about 100 years ago, this was the last great palace to be constructed by the Ottoman sultans. As with all emperors and kings of their day, they too surrounded themselves with great luxury. The formal gardens and other 19th century immensities suggest the strong French influence much in vogue throughout Europe at the time. Elaborate interiors of the palace drip with the luxury that characterized the sultan's lives. No simple fireplace would do. It had to be elaborate beyond description. A chair to support his sultanic majesty or royal guest needed to be golden, no less. Rulers throughout the world were interested in impressing contemporary sultans. Tsar Nicholas II presented a 3.5-ton chandelier to one of them. Napoleon, who apparently ran his own publicity department, gave a sultan a table of beautiful porcelain portraits featuring himself and various women of his court. A painting of Mehmet II, conqueror by wall. By pulling his ships over a peninsula of land to the Golden Horn one night in 1453, Mehmet II surprised the Greek defenders and took this city. it has been Turkish ever since. Mehmet II thus bypassed the nearly impregnable city walls in what may well have been one of history's earliest amphibious operations. These walls are crumbling today and but vaguely suggest their once great strength. Looking carefully, you may yet find one solitary sentinel high upon the wall, who looks as though he has been here for the intervening 500 years and plans on standing here for the rest of time. The Golden Horn, into which the boats were pulled, is visited today by coastal vessels like this Black Sea trader. These small boats bring the produce of coastal areas to the great metropolis of Istanbul, taking back the commodities originating here or in other parts of the country or in other parts of the world. Because the sea has long afforded the easiest and most economical transportation, the greatest concentration of population in Turkey is along its many shores, including the Black Sea coast. Small rowboats pleasantly ferry you across the Golden Horn if you wish. A few miles north of where the Golden Horn drains into the Bosphorus is Rumeli Hisar. Here is the narrowest point in the Bosphorus, with Asia on one side, Europe on the other. Down through history, Persian, Roman, Greek, and Turkish rulers and their conquering soldiers surged back and forth over these narrows. Mehmet II built this castle in 3 months, and from it controlled trade passing through the Bosphorus. It also served as a base of operations from which to launch the attack on Istanbul, turning it into a Turkish city 500 years ago. Towers and walls of this old fortress castle are in a good state of preservation. It is one of the most interesting ruins in Europe. Beautiful gardens grace the shores of the Bosphorus. There are many reasons for calling Istanbul a garden city, and this is but one of them. You might well have walked right by this garden behind its high wall had not the gate been open invitingly. On the garden side of the wall is a graceful fountain with small rivulets of water cascading from one small basin to the next, falling eventually to a lily-studded pool. While neither human nor animal forms appear in old decorative themes in Turkey, there is no lack of color or movement in a pool inhabited by goldfish. An additional splash of color is achieved if a peacock graces the garden and displays his regal breast feathers. Their iridescence is in sharp contrast to sheer white marble and the shimmer of fish beneath the water. Flowers are part of the Turkish scene. You find them used extensively on such occasions as Army Day, with memorial pieces being placed at the base of the Monument of the Republic in Istanbul's Taksim Square. The Turkish Army is a valuable democratic instrument protecting a way of life, in sharp contrast to the communism subjugating the peoples of several neighboring countries. In common with the USA, Turkey subscribes to the theory a state exists for the welfare of its people and not the other way around. The Turkish Army, along with armed forces of other democratic nations, is dedicated to the preservation of peace and the maintenance of forces strong enough to implement that peace. Turkey has compulsory military service. 2 years enlistment is required of men of military age. American technical assistance and military equipment have been placed at the disposal of Turkey. As a member of the United Nations, Turkey demonstrated in Korea her readiness to assume a full measure of responsibility for human decency and international order. The nation's strategic location at the eastern end of the Mediterranean makes her an exceedingly important member of the North Atlantic Treaty Organization. The Navy is also an important branch of Turkey's armed forces. There are hundreds of miles of coastline, and the Bosphorus and adjoining waterways connecting the Black Sea and the Mediterranean constitute one of the world's most strategic waterways. The Navy has its day too, and on it the public has been invited to witness a regatta here on the Sea of Marmara. On a nearby launch, crowded with interested spectators, is a very young Turkish woman who, incidentally, demonstrates the degree of emancipation her sex has achieved. Speaking of situations, here is one Turkish boy who hasn't a chance. The vitality of Turkish life carries over into recreation. These sailors are putting everything they have into it as they sag on those oars. There is, of course, more leisurely recreation to be had, such as using the Lido pool by the Bosphorus. On weekends and holidays, people enjoy taking a ferry from Galata Bridge and heading for a nearby group of islands known as Adalar. You quickly leave behind the Istanbul skyline of mosques and minarets, and in an hour or so are Büyükada, largest of the group. This is but one of several very pleasant areas within a short distance of Istanbul. It is one of the more popular, however, for it is reached not only easily, but inexpensively. The nearby coffee house reminds us Turkey introduced coffee to Europe. No motor cars are permitted on Büyükada. Your carriage ride or other means of transportation are unhurried. Here, as elsewhere in Turkey, you will be reminded frequently of other parts of the world. For Turkey is that cosmopolitan. Picnicking is popular and makes a pleasant companion activity to swimming in picturesque bays. Pine-covered shores or bright sunlit beaches are yours for the choosing. There is plenty of inexpensive saltwater fun for everyone. And in summer, the islands play host to innumerable groups from the city. There are small private coves as well as large public beaches. It may be noticed in passing, there is little in the general scene that sets the beaches of Adalar apart from similar ones on Atlantic and Pacific seaboards of the USA. While we are on the subject of recreation, we might mention there are also enjoyable inland resorts easily reached from Istanbul. Some miles to the east on the Asiatic side beyond the Bosphorus are rolling hills. Nestled serenely among them is Lake Bolu. In the late spring, its wide open spaces are especially attractive. Mustard weeds have taken over the lake shore as their special domain. Their yellow blossoms add a splash of color to the landscape. The water buffalo is one of the world's main beasts of burden, especially in the Far East. But it is also as common in Turkey as in Siam or China. As its name implies, it is as much at home in the water as out of it. In fact, daily immersion is a must in its life. The longer it is left to soak, the better it likes it. Swimming through lily pads and reeds is obviously a delightful pastime. This fellow looks as though he hadn't a care in the world. Nearby, along the shores of the lake, you may encounter a camper who has abandoned the comforts of city life for a night out under the stars. At a lakeside hotel are a group of Istanbul school teachers on a holiday trip. At the moment, on a sunny patio, they are holding an impromptu fashion parade. Everyone seems to be getting a hand except the girl in red. Could be she hasn't been counting her calories lately. The surrounding hills constitute one of the few timbered areas in Turkey. The great Anatolian plains are largely devoid of trees today. It is thought they were once heavily wooded, but ancient peoples are assumed to have timbered them for their galleons. A carefully run forest industry now harvests trees with an eye on the future as well as on the present. Draft animals pulling heavy lumber wagons move timber to loading points where it is transferred to trucks or railway cars. Mountains, too, are within reach of Istanbul. There is Mount Olympus, not the one of Greek fame, but Turkey's. It is a popular area of wide open spaces. As you approach this flower-decked mountain house, you could readily imagine yourself in the Swiss or Austrian Alps. In the appearance of the people and their utilization of the area, you could easily imagine yourself in the Pacific Northwest, such as Washington or Oregon. Nature is lavish in her gifts of beauty to most mountain areas throughout the world. Almost in the shadow of Mount Olympus and amid the rolling hills of southwestern Turkey is the city of Bursa, centuries ago capital of the Ottoman Empire. A modern, progressive city today, it nevertheless has many contacts with the past. In midsummer, you encounter caravans of silk cocoons in Bursa streets on their way to the silk market in the heart of town. This community has long been a center of Turkish silk culture. During the buying season, the silk market is a scene of high activity as morning trading gets underway. Buyers from the silk factories bid for the great baskets of cocoons that will be hustled off to storage warehouses as soon as purchases have been completed. Before looking in on a silk factory, let's visit a silkworm farm. Here you will find mulberry trees, the leaves of which are picked and fed to ravenously hungry silkworms. These insects make short work of leaf after leaf. They feed for about 8 weeks of their lives while in this caterpillar form, and this is the only phase in which they eat. Presently, all interest in food is gone, and each worm undertakes to spin a cocoon for itself. For the next 4 or 5 days, it will spin continuously. Two tiny spinnerets in the mouth exude a fluid that solidifies upon contact with the air, and a double fiber is formed with which the insect encases itself in one unbroken strand, frequently in excess of 7,000 feet in length. With spinning over, the cocoons go to market. The worm has changed to a dormant chrysalis, as seen in this cut-open cocoon. The chrysalis, while dormant, is killed with steam, otherwise a moth would struggle free, staining the cocoon in the process, as it secretes a fluid dissolving the natural gum holding the fiber in place. At the silk factory, cocoons are processed and transformed into cloth. Of many interesting operations involved, one of the neatest is getting the cocoons unraveled and wound up in convenient form for handling. This problem has been solved more easily than you might expect. In a vat of hot water, a batch of cocoons is agitated with a coarse brush. This softens the outer part, and presently the beginning of that long, continuous strand works free, and the operator catches nearly every individual one on her rough brush. Skeining follows as other workers disentangle the jumbled mass and make long continuous threads on revolving racks overhead. This is exacting work and no job for anyone who is the nervous type. But by patiently separating the threads, each fiber can be disentangled and the cocoons will unravel smoothly from this point on. Once the skeins are removed from the winding racks, they must pass inspection before being dyed. While we will make no attempt to follow the full manufacturing process, let's look in on at least a few of the colorful operations. Here, bobbins are being wound with thread to be worked into fabric the narrow way. They will be shuttled back and forth in the weaving machine, making the woof. Meanwhile, spools are wound with threads to run the long way of the fabric, making the warp. Many spools at a time will be mounted on multiple racks and taken up by large drums, later to be worked off onto rollers and transferred to weaving machines. Here, warp and woof meet as mechanical manipulation enables the pattern to take shape. The bobbins, already wound with colorful threads, will be shuttled back and forth as they are worked into one continuous bolt of cloth. Colorful silk fabrics so manufactured are headed for the bazaars and shops of Turkey, as well as for the more exclusive shops of Paris, London, and Berlin. The entire southwestern area is also very productive agriculturally. Turkish dried fruits have long been especially known throughout the markets of the world. Fresh fruit for domestic consumption is equally important. On the Dikenjik farm, meaning little thorn, the peach harvest is in progress. Bursa peaches enjoy a happy reputation as one of the country's choicest fruits. Those of you familiar with fruit orchards in America would feel very much at home on a Bursa farm. Wagons carry the fruit to the packing sheds, there to be transferred to trucks for distribution. Turkish tobacco is a widely known product. There are large tobacco farms in this area. It is from plants such as these that the mature leaves are picked. Harvesting is a laborious process, for each leaf must be selected individually and picked at the right time and by hand. Before the leaves can be hung in the sun to cure, they must be pierced by a long needle and transferred to stout thread. At the present moment, it looks as though this tobacco farmer is receiving some good supervision from his modern young daughter. Exposure to sunlight for a few days will change the leaves from their original deep green to the rich golden brown of cured tobacco. Sunlight has changed other things in Bursa too. The tiles of the green tomb have, in recent centuries, changed in color to a deep blue, though the structure is still known as the Green Tomb. As an old capital of the Ottoman Empire, before the seat of government was moved from here several centuries ago, Bursa holds the tombs of many Turkish sultans. Bursa has many summertime and holiday visitors, and in visits to this area, a young Turk may learn some of the history of his nation. But whatever was said to this little fellow about history or anything else appears to have had an undesirable effect. Someone is on the verge of tears. However, there is a Bursa way of banishing tears from young eyes. It is karagöz, which was developed in this city a full 500 years ago. Backstage, an operator manipulates colored figures against a translucent screen. Centuries ago, Turkey had this forerunner of today's color motion pictures. Here, karagöz is telling its own story. It is used today primarily for the entertainment of children. There may be a period in a Turkish boy's life when he is temporarily confined to bed. There he is happy to be entertained by clowns as capable as these two. While projection of the karagöz figures involves a very short throw from figure to screen, isn't it essentially the same principle by which this color film, Introducing Turkey, is being exhibited to you? Many talented personalities pass across the karagöz screen, such as these active dancers who achieve a lifelike quality at the hands of a skillful operator. Their size suggests the clowns may have been dwarfs. Knowing the high esteem in which athletics is held in Turkey, it is not surprising to find this tightrope walker appearing on the scene. He is obviously a skillful fellow, for it seems that with the help of the karagöz operator, he has acquired the ability to completely disregard gravity. Returning from the play world of karagöz to reality, we are reminded that beauty is a prominent part of the Turkish scene. Mountains and sandy, oleander-covered beaches serve to emphasize there is a great deal to please the eye in this part of the world. Few areas exceed Turkey's Mediterranean shores for sheer natural beauty. There is one section near Antalya where a subterranean river emerges from beneath coastal mountains. The water has been running underground through the Anatolian plains, and here bursts from hiding to flow along the surface and eventually tumble into the sea. You will need to ride along the shore by boat to see this waterfall to best advantage. The ancient galleons of old visit these shores no more, though at times you think you see one, and old Roman shops below the Blue Mosque are empty. But superimposed on the ancient scene is the up-to-date 20th century life of a revitalized nation. Airline buses are encountered in city streets today instead of camel caravans. Modern aviation has made world neighbors of the USA and Turkey. Today, American and Turk are welcome in each other's country, and we are pleased that it is so. The peoples of our respective nations hold a common attitude toward life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And both uphold the principles on which international order and human decency are based.